make music with the heavens, we will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise.
Well, good morning, and I hope you came to do some singing this morning. I know this might feel like it's an hour earlier for some reason for everybody, but that's okay. We're going to get energized and get going here. We want to welcome you to Belmont. This is a place where we follow Jesus and grow in faith and make a difference, and we'll hope that you'll stand with us now and join with us as we begin worship with our call to worship. Oh, God. You are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water.
So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you.
So I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands and call your name. Amen. We're going to continue in worship now, singing Better Is One Day.
Tasted and I
Join me together in this prayer. Heavenly Father, help us to earnestly seek you first above all else. Your presence enriches our lives. You bring us peace in times of calamity and refuge in times of trouble. Teach us to trust you with all that we have, that we may hold nothing back, that we may experience what it means to be fully known and loved by you. We turn away from sin and idols and turn wholly to you this day. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Songs of deliverance whenever I am afraid, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. Let the weak say, I am strong. In the strength of the Lord,
you are my hiding place, you always fill my heart with songs of
trust in you. Let the weak say, I am strong in the strength of the Lord.
I will trust in you.
Let's turn to our first scripture reading this morning, which comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 12. He sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to this treasury. For all of them had contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for mourning, and we thank you for gathering us together. You are an amazing God, and you remind us through your word of what is important. We're reminded in this scripture that it wasn't about the amount. It was about the heart and how this widow gave everything she had. It didn't add up to a lot as far as the standards of adding it together. But she gave everything she had. And so in Jesus' eyes, it was the greatest gift as he watched everyone giving their offerings. But God, she gave everything. And it seems that we would want to give everything of ourselves back to you because you actually gave us life. Life in the very beginning where you breathed in air into us. You created us in your image. And then once again, you gave us life through the death on the cross and your resurrection. You gave us eternal life. So it seems, Lord, that nothing that we have would be withheld from you, that we would offer ourselves, that we would offer our possessions, that we would be willing to offer everything. to you, the King of Kings. So God, as we hear the scriptures this morning, we hear your word this morning, may we look deep inside to see where we are. It's always good to take a check to see where we are. We thank you, Lord God, that you are with us, that you encourage us, that you love us unconditionally, that you love us even when we may make wrong decisions. You still love us. You give us opportunities to repent. You give us opportunities to go different directions. So Lord God, may open our eyes and our ears and our minds that we may hear from you today, that we may see what you have for us. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We pray for all those that need special healings this day, whether it's physical healings or spiritual healings or mental, financial, whatever it is, we lift them to you, knowing that nothing is too great for you, that you can conquer anything. And miracles happen each and every day. So where miracles are needed, Lord, we pray for them. And you know everyone's hearts, and you know everyone's situation. And so God, come and be with us. Surround us with your love and your mercy and your grace. We thank you, Lord Jesus, and we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. We'll invite you to stand again at this time as you are able, and join us in our song of preparation. Alas, and did my Savior bleed? Hymn number 359.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed? Maker died for his own creature's sin. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. The drops of tears can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself.
It's a great day to be in the house of the Lord this morning, and I am so glad that you are here in the sanctuary or by live stream. I'm Becky Foltz, Children's Coordinator, and we were going to take a moment here to check out our announcements. So there is a connect card here. We would love to be connected to you. If you are a first-time guest, welcome. There is some space on the back for prayer concerns, and we pray for these on an ongoing basis every Wednesday. Pastor Jan has a special announcement to kick us off here this morning.
Thank you. This is in your bulletin, and I mentioned last week, but just so it's a refresher, and you might have thought of somebody since last week, but the church needs a host to be responsible for opening and closing the church building on Saturday mornings from 10:30 a.m. till noon, and we also need a host on Wednesday starting on April 3rd, and the building, to open the building and any required doors from 6 to approximately 8:30 p.m. And so both positions are paid positions. They're both $15 per hour. So if you know somebody that would be fit that spot and is reliable to be in that spot, please let Rod Clark or Susan know in the office so that we can have that spot, those spots covered. So thank you.
Thank you. And we are in the season of Lent, and we are patiently awaiting Easter, which is the 31st this year, the end of the month. And so we have some special events coming up on March 24th. There will be a joint craft and bake sale. So bring your checkbooks and your cash, and make sure you get here early, because even though it's after the service, I have learned the good stuff is gone. So you don't want to miss out. And then we do have upcoming Holy Week services. And so we will have our Monday, Thursday, and our Good Friday services. Special things planned for those at 7 p.m. On that Saturday, the 30th, we have our annual Easter egg hunt. So bring out all the kids that you know. We will meet here at 10:30 to 11 for pictures with the Easter Bunny and activities, and then sharply at 11 a.m., whoosh, the egg hunt happens, and it's over in 2 minutes. So if you're 2 minutes late, you've missed it. So make sure you get here before then. And then we have our youth breakfast in the morning on Easter Sunday. So this is such a great time of fellowship and gathering. And there are a couple of fundraisers. So we do have our pancake breakfast, but also Lainey, one of our youth, has been developing a second cookie fundraiser, and there's more information in the insert of that. And then don't forget your Easter flower orders. You can also order those and put those in the bulletin or give those to Miss Susan. And then following our Easter season, we do have a spring cleaning coming up April 20th. So mark all of these dates down and make sure you've got them. And please look in the bulletin for any other occurring events and ongoing activities. All right, children, now's the time for you to come and see me. Bells, no?
Coins.
Ooh, coins. I've got coins. What are coins?
Money.
Money. Money. Money, 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 money. Money. Who likes money?
Me.
It's hard not to like money. What do we use money for?
To buy things.
We use money to buy things. So the clothes that we're wearing, somebody had to buy, right? Yep. My glasses are expensive. They are very expensive, but I wear them every day. Every day they're on my face, so they're worth it to me to pay out that money because it makes me see better, right? Everything takes money. So if there's something going on, we end up with a leak on the roof. What has to happen? We gotta have money because we gotta fix it. We gotta pay someone to fix it, right? Everything here on this earthly life takes money. Well, guess what? There's a couple passages in Matthew that I want to talk to you about. In Matthew 6, there's something important. It says that you cannot serve two masters. Give me a number two. Can you put up two? Two. Says you cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve both money and God. Says you will love one and hate the other. Uh-oh, that's pretty strong, right? I happen to really love money. But it says if I love money, then that might be the root of evil that causes me to hate God. That's a strong word. Well, then, in Matthew 24, same book of the Bible, so Matthew 6, it says you can't serve both money and God. But then, in Matthew 24, we learn about Judas and what happened with Judas. Judas was one of the 12 disciples.
He had to turn against God.
He turned against Jesus. He turned him in for what?
Money.
Money. Coins. He paid off some people to turn Jesus over to them. So do you think Jesus, or do you think Judas, which master do you think he was serving at that point in time?
Money.
The devil, yes, and money, right? He wasn't serving Jesus, he wasn't serving God, he was serving money. So yes, money is important. It's important we have to use it to buy everything. But it says that we need to serve who?
God.
God. And so I want you to remember that. That as you grow,
it says if you serve God, then you can hunger for God and not be hungry.
Yeah, that's right. If we hunger for God, we won't be hungry again. And so if we hunger for God, God is going to give us what we need, right? He'll supply the funds for what we need. But if we are focusing on money, we are focusing on the wrong things. And so we want to serve the Lord. And right now, who usually has the money who takes care of you?
God.
Well, yes, God, but also your parents, right? So usually, Solomon, I don't make you go and buy your own jeans.
No.
I usually go and buy your own jeans, right?
Yes.
But as you get older and as you take on more responsibilities and bills come in, you're going to rely more and more and more on what? On money, and it's easy to rely less and less and less on who? God. And so this is an important thing that I want you to learn while you're young. It's just like you depend on your parents to feed and clothe you, you can depend on God for everything that you need and not yourselves. Let's go to God in prayer about that. Let's close our eyes. Dear God, we thank you that you are our provider, and we pray, Lord, that as we have needs and that that it is easy to get caught up on money and the things that we need to buy with that money, Lord, I pray that we will keep you first, that we will put you as our number one master, that we will not be a slave to money, but that we will serve you, and that we will rely on you for all that we need. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's go learn more about coins and
so we have been talking through this Lenten service about things that are probably common to us and how they can tie into our season of Lent. And so we've talked about dust and bread. We have talked about last week the cross. And this week we talk about coins. And there are coins, if you did not get any, there are coins that you're welcome to have. A coin that will not buy you anything, but it does have important scriptures on it, so you can glean from the scripture, which would be more valuable than what it could possibly buy. But we have coins, which are commonplace. As we hear various scriptures, they are commonplace. And so we already heard the scripture from Mark about the poor widow who came and gave two small copper coins that were worth a penny. And Jesus noticed. He noticed as people were giving, and he knew that some were giving out of abundance, but this lady, this widow lady, gave everything she had. And so he asked the disciples, who gave the greatest amount? And he responded, he told them that the greatest amount was given by the lady who gave it all. And so she had contributed everything she had to live on. So in Matthew 26 is the scripture Becky was referring to. Then one of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, what will you give me if I betray him to you? They paid him 30 pieces of silver. And from that moment on, he began to look for an opportunity to betray him, which was Jesus. 30 pieces of silver, and he was willing to betray the one that he had been walking with for all of this time. He was willing for 30 pieces of silver. There's more to that story, so I encourage you to read what happens to Judas. But he betrays Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. Now, prophecy and the scriptures have told us that there's certain things that have to happen. And so somebody needed to betray him, and so it just happens to be Judas. In John chapter 2, the Gospel of John, the Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem, and in the temple he found people selling cattle, sheep and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple. With the sheep and the cattle, he also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace. You don't see Jesus getting mad very often, and you don't see this side, but he was seeing what was happening to the temple, to the place that was supposed to be the house of prayer, the place of worship, and it had become something that was not like that at all. His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. The Jews then said to him, what sign can you show for doing this? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, this temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days. But Jesus was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. See, he wasn't pleased with what was happening in the temple and how the money changers were present. The Gospel of Luke 15, it asks the question, or what woman having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Jesus cares about, it goes with that scripture about if one sheep is lost. It's kind of a similar scripture that if something is lost, how much we care about it, how much more Jesus cares about a person that does not know him, that he cares so much about him. So I was thinking about the woman with the ten silver coins, and she searches her house till she finds it. And I thought about myself, and I do not like to lose things. I don't like to lose things. So I will be the one that would be looking and looking until I found whatever it was that I lost. Well, one particular time as I was visiting my mom, we have our one car has one key. It came with one key. A wise person would go make another one. But so far, we still have one key, so nobody's been wise yet to go make another one. But anyway, I was loading the car and my keys, in the midst of my putting stuff in the car, disappeared. And I looked everywhere. Even the neighbor helped me look. I looked under the car. I looked in all sorts of spaces. And I thought, and I called the garage and I said, "Is there any way you could make a key for me?" And they couldn't do it right then. And so, you know, I prayed. I said, "Lord, do you know where my key is?" My key had fallen. There's a third set of seats that are usually folded down in the back. And it had slid down into those seats. It was only by the grace of God that I found it, because I didn't know that's where it had disappeared to. But there was rejoicing in finding that key, because the car doesn't do much if you don't have a way to start it. And so Jesus reminds us that while those things are important to us, there's something more important to him. And that is that everybody knows who he is and knows the saving grace that comes from Jesus Christ. It matters to him. Every person who doesn't know Jesus matters to Jesus. And so that is that scripture about how important that is. In Matthew 10, and these are just scriptures that help us understand where the money is. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. You know, that's that. There's a song, "His eye is on the sparrow, so I know he's watching me." God cares more for us. To even have the number, our hairs numbered on our head. He knows us inside and out. What an awesome thing that is, to know that. And then the book of Ezra says, as soon as they came to the house of the Lord in Jerusalem, some of the heads of families made freewill offerings for the house of God to erect it on its site. According to their resources, they gave to the building fund 61,000 derricks of gold, 5,000 minas of silver, and 100 priestly robes. They had been in exile, the Israelites, for 50 years in Babylon, and they returned to their homeland, and the place of worship is in ruins. And they were determined to restore it. They were determined to restore it, so when they would gather, they would bring their offerings in hopes that they could rebuild and restore. Their offerings were bought. They were brought, and they were freely given. And as they were given, there's a casting of and shaping of the future. Generosity begets generosity. They believed that God had a plan, and his promises remain steadfast. God does have a plan. God has a plan for each one of us. God has a plan for our church. God has a plan that's bigger and better than any we can dream up. It's God's plan. And so coins matter. I was listening to a conversation with a couple of my granddaughters last week, and they were talking about, you know, we don't use actual money as much anymore to pay for things. Sometimes we use the cards instead. And so people aren't used to having change. And they were talking about how they really would rather not get change. They didn't know what to do with the change. They would really rather not get change. And I didn't enter this conversation. I just was listening. And I thought, you know, if you add all those things together, you could do something with the change. The change could add up. And they talked about how they thought about going to the bank and having it cashed in, but so far they had not done that. It was just interesting as I was listening to them discuss this part about having pennies and nickels and in those types of things. But there's still a purpose. It could become an offering. It could become an offering. So we are reminded that there's much in the scripture about coins and about money and our use of it. Malachi talks about how do not rob from God. And when asked why that was stated, it says in the scripture that you did not bring your whole tithe into the storehouse. You did not give of your whole tithe to the Lord. And so therefore, by not giving your whole tithe to the Lord, you're robbing from God. There's many things in the scripture that talk to us about money. And things that can guide us and can direct us in the Word of God. So I want to encourage us in these things that have as tangible, that are things that we are everyday things, how important they become. The bread for that Jesus uses that simple element of bread to break, and it illustrates his body given for us. How we are created out of dust. That dust we try to get rid of that lands on everything. But we have been created out of dust, and dust we will return until we are resurrected, if we believe in Jesus Christ. And then we talked about the cross last week. The cross. The cross that we sometimes wear, the cross that we put on various things. The cross that often looks beautiful when we see an image of the cross. But the price that was paid on the cross, it wasn't a beautiful cross. It was we sing the song, the old rugged cross. It was heavy. It was used for one of the worst deaths that there was, for crucifixion. While it can be something that we wear or we look at, we need to think even deeper about what that means. In this Lenten season, what does a cross mean to us? I shared this with the prayer group on Wednesday, but when Mark and I had the opportunity to go to Israel, which has been now quite a few years ago, but there's things that just stay in your mind. We were walking in the old city of Jerusalem. It was one of my favorite places. I had many favorite places when we went to Israel, but the old city of Jerusalem and the marketplace is kind of narrow, and you know, tons of fresh fruit and nuts, and people bartering their their wares, so you didn't just pay full price. You bartered for your what you wanted to buy. Sometimes you bartered. Our son Chris was much better at that bartering than I was. I didn't really want to barter, but he was much better at that. But the marketplace, so we are in the marketplace. We had gotten to a section of the marketplace where a lot of things have been buried in dust, and so architects have uncovered various parts of old, have been uncovered. And so in this one place of the marketplace, the stones had been uncovered, and they were considered to be over 2,000 years old, and most likely stones that would have been in the marketplace when Jesus walked through the marketplace or would go to the marketplace. And I remember standing on the stones, and right across from me was a person, and he was being held up. He wasn't being held up, but a policeman was going through his backpack. And it just made, it just kind of brought up the fact that of what was happening with Jesus as he was would have gone through that marketplace. Of people saying bad things to him, about him getting stabbed with the swords, about all the disgrace that was put upon him when he didn't deserve any of it. And it became a kind of a surreal space, I think, because those stones were there and there was the policeman there. And then you continued through the marketplace and it was crowded. And I thought about how Jesus had to endure all of those people, and he was perfectly innocent, but he did that for us. It changes when we stop to really think about the cross. It changes everything when we think it's us, it's me, it's you. Jesus went on that journey for us. It changes things. That's why the journey through Lent is important for us to ponder and to think about what various things might mean. And how important our knowing Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior is. And how important it is for others to know him as well. So simple elements that are part of our common everyday life. But there's some wonderful scriptures that point us and direct us and can lead us as we journey through the season of Lent, which was also the 40 days of being in the wilderness for Jesus. He combated the devil with the word of God, with scripture. That's why it's so important for us to know scripture, because when there was something that the devil would say that was wrong, he would quote scripture back to him. He set such an example for us. So ponder today about the coins and about all of these simple things that we have talked about and where they fit in your life. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for the lessons that we can learn as we read in the scriptures. We thank you for the lessons that we are to put money before you. We are to put you first. You are to be first, our God. Money, if we've made money our God, then we have not chosen you. We cannot worship both money and you. Help us, Lord, to look carefully at where we are so that we can make sure we are on the path that you have called us to be on. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the price that you paid, for the gift that you gave, for loving us so much. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. At this time, we invite our ushers to come forward as we partake in our morning offering.
Take my life and let it be. Come. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee.
Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee.
Father, we lift this offering up to you to bless your name, Lord. May we take our offerings, Lord, and our money and our gifts and talents and not hoard them for ourselves, not use them for evil purposes or selfish gain, but we surrender them to you to use as you will, Lord. May they extend your kingdom that we may be an outreach from this place to others, Lord, to show your love, to show your mercy and your kindness and your invitation, your welcoming spirit, Lord, in this community and beyond, Lord. We ask that you multiply these gifts beyond what we may think they're capable of, Lord. We give you all glory and honor in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As you remain standing, please join us in our closing song now this morning, Build Your Kingdom Here.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope like wildfire in church, and we pray your power in us. We seek your kingdom first, we hunger and we thirst, refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and pride. To see the captive hearts release, the hurt, the sick, the poor at least. We lay down our life for heaven's cause. We are your church, and we pray revive this earth. Oh, build your kingdom.
Hallelujah. Let us build our kingdom here so as you leave this place, it's an opportunity to share Jesus with all that you meet. So go knowing that you are loved beyond measure. Go in his mercy and grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.